Good morning, doctors. I am Dr. Ravindra Patel, representing Intas Animal Health. We are very thankful that you took some time and attending the live webinars. At the Intas Animal Health, we are constantly working to support you with the supply of our products, solution that can help you to serve your patient and of course, the pet parents. Doctors, it is very important to keep yourself safe in current situation. We also know as a pet practitioner, you are facing a tough time where you need to cure suffering pets and also assure pet parents about your commitment as a practitioner. So as a Intas, as a responsible animal healthcare company, would like to get you more interesting information, knowledge, and discuss at this need of our and strengthen your effort toward your commitment in current situations. So dear doctors, today we have a industry expert, a very well-known surgeon, Dr. S. Ayyappan sir with us to discuss and explain about canine osteoarthritis in current strategies and treatment and management. Sir, we are very privileged to have you. And what should I tell about the about you, the audience? You are well-known personality all India. Even though I took a privilege to introduce you some of your important achievements, Dr. Ayyappan sir is a first veterinarian from the India to get the AO Vet Fellowship at Small Animal Hospital in Switzerland. He is the only veterinarian from India to have completed the basic advanced specialized AO course and advanced AO fellowship at Cummins School of Veterinary Medicine, USA. Also, he underwent advanced spinal surgery training in small animal at Las Vegas, USA. He organized and functioned as a co-chairman at the first AO Vet Small Animal Basic Fracture Management course in 2012 in India. Ayyappan sir has completed postdoctoral training. He currently working as a professor and head Madras Veterinary College, Tanuvas, Chennai. He was also worked as a senior lecturer in veterinary surgery, small animal orthopedic department of clinical veterinary science, School of Veterinary Medicine, the University of West Indies, Trinidad. He is a recipient of Staff Research Award on project entitled Surgical Management of Segmental Tibial Fracture in Dogs with Locking Compression Plate using MIPO or Supercutaneous Plating Technique. Sir has also developed a prototype of a veterinary fixator for a small animal long bone fracture management for which an appreciation certificate was conferred from Tanuvas. Sir has also developed mini T plates to treat distal radial fracture in small size dog. Sir has also developed cost-effective ambulatory cart for rehabilitating paraplegic dogs. Sir is the first to introduce the concept of dynamic compressing plating, clamp rod fixation, hybrid fixator, locking compression plating, T plates, and external fixator at orthopedic units in the Tanuvas teaching complex, Madras Veterinary College. So it is a vast experience and the thorough knowledge on the surgical aspect. Now I request Ayyappan sir to take you through the today's session. Sir, we welcome you on board and we are very privileged to have you today. So now the audience is really want to hear you, sir. The session is over to you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, doctor. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, sir. You are very well audible.
Yeah. Thank you so much for your very nice introduction. And it's always a pleasure to meet my fellow vets and share some of my experiences with you. And hopefully you would get some information out of this session. Now I'm going to do the screen sharing for you first. Can you see my slides, please?
Visible, sir.
Good to go. Yeah. So good morning, everyone. And thank you all for coming on a Sunday. I know many of you would like to spend time with your family, your wife, some of you with your girlfriends. Probably many of you wouldn't know how to manage both of them. But that's a part how it goes. Okay. Just jokes apart. I just wanted to keep you a little entertained. Okay. Here's my first slide. Why do you want to treat canine osteoarthritis? Okay. Yeah, this is just to get you more, you know, get you an adrenaline going in. So the most important thing is life is movement, movement is life. Well, nothing better than watching the carnival in the Caribbean. So, you know, you don't have osteoarthritis, you dance like this. Okay, now let's go to the topic as such. Now that you people are wide awake and you watch what you want to see, let us go to the topic as such. Okay. So what's going to be a learning objective for today? Number one, you should know what is osteoarthritis. A very small amount of what is the pathogenesis. How do you classify osteoarthritis and how do you stage it? Very important from the clinical perspective. Your basic clinical signs and diagnostic methods, medical management, some of the newer concepts, and surgical treatment. Okay. See, what is osteoarthritis? See, you should understand that osteoarthritis is it is not a disease entity. It is a progression of a disease. It is not a disease entity as such. Okay, it is not. So when you say osteoarthritis, it is not that this is the disease. It is a progression of the disease. Okay, the other synonym what we use for osteoarthritis, many of us tend to use the term called degenerative joint disease. It's completely fine with me. Okay. Remember, osteoarthritis is a young dog disease. It's a young dog disease, which we find out when the dog is old. Okay, do you get my point? So it starts early, but we find out when it has come to a stage where the animal is old and it is exhibiting far more severe symptoms than what we expect. So what do you expect to find on osteoarthritis? You'll find gross changes. You'll find histopathological changes. You'll find biochemical changes. You'll find biomechanical changes. So you're going to see four changes. That's why this makes it very hard for animals. It also makes it very hard for the owner to deal with animals which are suffering from a poor quality of life. Okay. Now, the basic anatomy is what does it contain? What does a joint contain? A joint has got what's called as an articular cartilage, and you have got what is called as the chondrocyte matrix. That's all. So you have a joint. The joint is covered by a membrane called the synovial membrane, okay, or the synovial capsule, or whatever you can call it. And you have what is called as the chondrocyte matrix. The chondrocyte matrix has got two components. One is collagen. The other is proteoglycans. Okay. So collagen is what will give you the tensile strength. It will withstand tension. And the proteoglycans is what will, which will withstand the compressive forces on the joint. So these two guys together would sort of support your joint. Okay. Now, in a dog, if you look at a dog and a human being, osteoarthritis is a completely different entity. In the dog, it is slowly progressive disease. Whereas in human, you get this condition called RPOA, rapidly progressive osteoarthritis. There are very, very few anecdotal reports in dogs for now. We will not bother about RPOA. This is just for your information. Okay. Every one of you know this. What are the main factors? Genetics. Okay. Now, genetics, what happens is this polymorphism is supposed to be inherited. This is polymorphism gets inherited, and they have a very positive influence on what is called as the cyclooxygenase enzyme, which plays a very important role in inflammation. Age. age, you know, as the animal ages, the cartilage, which is made up of what is called as aggrecan molecules, the quantity of aggrecan molecules comes down. Third, sex of the animal. Okay, I'll show it to you as we go by. The female neutered dogs, okay, a lot of studies have shown, female neutered dogs have a more prevalence of osteoarthritis, okay, which is probably, which explains that it's hormonal. Obesity, very, very important role in progression of osteoarthritis, because, you know, any obese persons, they basically produce something called adipokines, which are basically cytokines. And these are going to enhance the inflammatory process. The last factor which really influences the onset of osteoarthritis is exercise, diet, and housing. I know a lot of you say that don't keep this dog on a slippery surface. You're absolutely right. Okay, a study with about 45 puppies have shown that you keep the dog on a slippery surface, the onset of osteoarthritis at a later stage was much more quicker than a dog which was kept in a rough flooring. Diet, high fat, high energy diets always would accelerate the process of osteoarthritis. Okay, what are the causes of osteoarthritis? You all know it's very, very simple. Direct trauma. Most commonly, direct traumas cause, like, let's say, cruciate ligament rupture, which every one of us is aware of, number one, or an articular fracture in the joint. These are all direct traumas, which can be a precursor for the development of osteoarthritis at a later date. Abnormal cartilage development, like you see, osteochondrosis dissecans. Most common what we see in practice, abnormal biomechanics. The dysplastic hip, which is the most common, most prevalent case in practice. Okay. Now, very quickly, I'm not going to deal too much with pathogenesis. Okay. Now, when you have this osteoarthritis, you are going to get two kinds of defects. See, there are five regions here in a cartilage. Okay. You should understand, cartilage is adural. That means it does not have much of a nerve supply. The main nerve supply in a cartilage is from something called C fibers. Okay. It's called C fibers. This is the only fibers which supply cartilage. And these are called silent fibers. They don't perceive too much pain in a normal joint, right? And also, you know, the nutrition to the cartilage is not through a vascular supply. You know, this is avascular as such. So nutrition to the cartilage is through diffusion. Okay, from the joint capsule, you have the synovial fluid which diffuses. So any damage, you will get either partial thickness or a full thickness defect. When you have a partial thickness defect, there won't be much of a healing. You don't have much issues. Full thickness defects, they get replaced by fibrocartilage. Okay. Now, what happens in an onset of osteoarthritis? I try to make it very simple for you. I don't want to complicate it. Number one is the changes in the molecular level. Now, what happens is, when you have changes, early changes in osteoarthritis, the water content, okay, the water content in the synovial fluid will start slightly increasing. So when it starts slightly increasing, now these are all what I said, the chondrocyte matrix has got two properties. One is collagen, other is called proteoamyloglycans. These collagen fibers, they are all basically cross-linked. They are all cross-linked. These cross-linkages will start becoming weak and it will swell up. Okay, they will start getting damaged. Okay, normally what is your cartilage? Basically, there is anabolism, that is formation, catabolism, where there is destruction. Here, what happens is, once this destruction starts, it becomes self-perpetuating. You are going to get a lot of what is called as pro-inflammatory cytokines. Okay, you have interleukin-1, interleukin-17, interleukin 18, you're also going to have something called tumor necrosis factor. These are all going to increase. This is one way. The other thing is, you know, the COX. You're going to see about COX-1 and COX-2 enzymes. The cyclooxygenase enzymes play a very vital role. These also are going to increase your inflammatory mediators. The common mediators they are going to increase for you is what is called as matrix metalloproteinases. Okay. The third most important thing is something called nitrous oxide. That is also a potent mediator of inflammation causing damage to the cartilage. The synovium, the synovial layer, which covers your joint, also will have issues. They'll start getting thickening. They're also going to, for their part, they're also going to potentiate inflammatory mediators. Then, subchondral bone. So, chondrum is the cartilage. Just under that is the subchondral bone. The subchondral bone is going to first thin out. Once it first it thins out, then it becomes thickened. It develops cysts. Called subchondral bone cyst, then it becomes thickened, it becomes subchondral sclerosis. Then you are going to get pain. A normal joint, as I told you earlier, is not going to show any pain. You have only C fibers, ABC. C fibers, which do not are called silent fibers and do not perceive any pain at all. Now, once your subchondral bones get damaged, it is not a normal joint. It is an abnormal joint. You have pain receptors called nociceptors. And then you're going to get something called central sensitization. And the animal is going to perceive pain. Okay? Now, why do we need to know the stages? So that we can interfere early. The first is the mild stage. Mild stage, small little burn first, will start developing and it'll cause inflammation and pain. First is the minor, then second is the mild stage. In the mild stage, the erosion of the bone will happen. It's only the erosion. Okay. And you will get, because of this, you'll get new bone growth. This is called osteophyte. Now, where do you see? You'll have two things. One is called osteophyte. The other is called enthesiophyte. Osteophyte forms at the point of the joint, the cartilage at the joint. That's where it is. So, let's say if you have femur and tibia, it will form at the cartilage junctions. Okay. Enthesiophyte will develop at the junction where a tendon or a ligament attaches to the bone. Okay, the same thing, bone spurs. Remember bone spurs, you don't have to bother about osteophytes and enthesiophytes. After that, the moderate stage comes in. First is thinning out. Then the second is completely thinned out. The space becomes narrow. The cartilage goes off, causing grinding. Okay, first it's thinning out. Then space is gone. It starts grinding. Once it starts grinding, cartilage is gone. The final stage comes off. Cartilage is gone. You have only subchondral bone. That is where stage 4. Unfortunately, many of these cases we see only when they come to stage 3 and stage 4. Okay. This is how it is. Grade 1, they walk well. Mild osteo, this sort of reluctance is there. Stage 3, really reluctant to walk. Stage 4 is completely laying down. Okay. Now, it's a new concept which has come in, which is called COAST. This is a staging tool for osteoarthritis. Okay. Only thing you need to spend a little few more minutes to look at, you know, treat osteoarthritis well and stage it. Okay. In a COAST tool, what they are doing is, it's a very simple tool. It's not at all a complicated one. Very, very simple tool. You take into account the owner assessment of the condition, the veterinarian assistant of the assessment of the condition, and you grade and stage the condition. Okay. Now, this has been developed in thing with Elanco. If I'm right, they've developed it with Elanco, and it's a tool which is doing very well. So, what you do is, you just need to give the owners or you can ask them to download something. This is called CMI, Clinical Metrology Instrument. So Clinical Metrology Instrument is basically a questionnaire. The basic questionnaire, which has really been very popular now, is what is called as the Liverpool Liverpool Osteoarthritis in Dogs. You can just get it off the net. It's not at all a problem. It's a very simple questionnaire which the owner fills up, okay, and comes to you. You can also use other questionnaires. These are all called clinical metrology instruments. You can use the canine brief pain inventory. You can use Helsinki chronic pain index. Okay. Step B. So the owner comes to you with the CMI. That's called clinical metrology. He is having his own viewpoints. Next, you evaluate. You are going to evaluate the gait. You are also going to evaluate the joint. Okay, regular physical examination, etc. Okay, now the unusual thing here is the grading system of the owner would probably a little different from what you see, what you perceive. Your perceptions will be different. For example, one dog may have a severe osteoarthritis, but absolutely no change, no signs of pain and normal gait. So you grade this as a mild. Another dog may have mild arthritis in multiple joints with difficulty in gait. That you may get it as severe. So having these two, you have a very simple tool. This is a nice paper available in the veterinary journal. You can get it online. You simply grade your base. This is called the COAST system. So zero is normal. The owner is sort of confirming with you. One is clinically normal, factors are present. That helps you to start treatment right away. Two is mild, three is moderate, four is severe. Pretty easy system to use. I would encourage you people to use this in practice because you spend more time on the dog, it's more money. Okay. Now let's come to osteoarthritis as such. Basically, everyone knows there is inflammatory, non-inflammatory kind of diseases. You can also classify it as idiopathic, traumatic, immune-mediated, or infected. We are not going to go too much. Ours is a non-inflammatory kind of osteoarthritis. Basically, it'd be primary or secondary. Commonly secondary. Okay. Three kinds of arthritis you get in dogs. Most common. Non-inflammatory, immune-mediated, septic inflammatory. You look at only three kinds. When you see, look at this is what the dog's hand has. Degenerative joint disease, which is non-inflammatory, septic inflammatory, or immune-mediated polyarthritis. Common thing between immune-mediated and septic inflammatory is the total protein will be more than 2.5 gram per deciliter. Whereas the non-inflammatory, it will be less than 2.5 gram per deciliter. Okay. Common sites. Every one of you know this. Hip, stifle, shoulder, elbow, spine. Okay. But remember, there's a very poor correlation between degree of change and severity of clinical signs. Okay. Dogs may be severe. Every one of you would experience in your practice. Dogs may have severe signs, severe clinical signs, but not much radiographic change and vice versa. Okay. Let's go to the diagnosis. Let's see what we can do in practice. First and foremost, physical examination is the linchpin for orthopedics. Okay. Your hands are your best tools. Nothing else. After that, all your accessories come in. Okay. All of us should do the physical exam really well. Obviously, the questionnaire from the owner would help you. Do the physical examination, try to stage it. Obviously, our next choice is the radiography examination in two views. We routinely take CBC and serum biochemistry. That is not at all a problem. Biomarkers are becoming popular. They are expensive. But one of the biomarkers which I would suggest for all of you in practice, which can be done in the lab, is CBC. I would stress on one thing called ESR, erythrocyte sedimentation rate. Erythrocyte sedimentation rate will give you, or the Westergren erythrocyte sedimentation rate will give you an indication of the degree of inflammation. I would suggest you do that. Serum chemistry. I would suggest CRP, C-reactive protein, is a good indicator of the sign of inflammation, which can be done in any lab. Obviously, biomarkers have still not become very popular. Okay. You do the arthrocentesis, synovial fluid analysis should become more popular, because it is one thing is, it is a good diagnostic tool for you. The second thing is, it is a good modality for you to improve the standards of your practice, standards of diagnosis, and also, you know, more commercial viability is there. Okay. Obviously, other things are maybe a little more on the difficult side, biopsy, serology, and arthroscopy. Okay. Everyone knows this. Most lamenesses are chronic in nature. They become worse after exercise. Okay. Become more stiff. And cold, damp weather will aggravate the condition. Okay, I'll go through this quickly. So they're reluctant to exercise, they're inactive, they have pain. Then you do use your cupped fingers to compare both the joints. You'll have warmth, you'll have joint effusion, you'll have muscle atrophy, you'll have joint thickening. When you see chronic crude ligament for a long time, you'll find joint thickening in the medial aspect. That is called as buttress. It's called the medial buttress. You should be able to see that. Range of motion. Normally in dogs, most joints will be somewhere between 90 to 100, 115. If you're very particular, you can use a what is called as a goniometer to measure the range of motion. Altered gait, most important, altered behavior. Okay, these are the basic signs of an osteoarthritis. Remember this code. It's called CREPI. Okay. Works for any musculoskeletal system. C stands for crepitus. R stands for range of motion. E stands for effusion. P stands for pain. And I stands for instability. So if you can remember this, these are the five codes which you would use for any musculoskeletal system. And this is a very good code which you can use to check for osteoarthritis. Okay. Very simple, you evaluate the gait, and then one of the nice things is to do a sit test. Okay. The sit test is just make the dog sit. Okay. The brown dog is my dog, which I just took to show you. Normally, dogs will sit like a sphinx. Just swing, you know, the pyramid, the sphinx. Okay. If you find any unusual resting position, you see the rot here. He has a, you know, he tucked his joints in. Okay. And then his expression is not very happy. He sort of tucked it in to try to make it. So I would definitely check the joints. I would definitely check the elbow and try to rule out an elbow disease. Okay. You have dogs where they have bilateral degenerative joint disease, bilateral cruciate ligament ruptures. They'll walk like as if they're walking on an eggshell. They'll tiptoe. They'll be very, very careful about how they're walking. And they will try to get both the feet under the spine. So they will not be placing it apart, but they will try to get it under the spine. Okay. And then whenever you want to do a synovial fluid analysis, a joint tap. A normal joint tap, a volume of joint fluid, when you have, let's say a normal leg will be probably between 1 drop to 1 ml. That's as max you get. Okay. But when you're suspecting an acute synovitis associated with early degenerative joint disease, the volume will be much more. And if it's a chronic disease where there is a lot of joint thickening, your volume is going to be less than 0.5 ml. Okay. The pain in osteoarthritis is going to be due to three things. Our main point in osteoarthritis, every owner wants is, please make my dog feel more comfortable. It can be due to synovitis, microfractures, or periosteal irritation by osteophytes. Okay. I want to spend the next two slides on pain. All of us know pain is it's a major problem in osteoarthritis. So, A, you should know what is acute pain and what is chronic pain. What is acute pain? Acute pain is the the pain that exists, okay, for during the time of inflammation and healing. Acute pain, you can consider acute pain up to 3 months. Okay, any pain that goes beyond 3 months is going to be chronic pain. Okay, so the first pain what you're going to get is what is called as nociceptive pain. That's the point where, as a veterinarian, I would like to play a role. Okay, nociceptive pain occurs when peripheral I told you the chondral bone will go away, the nociceptive receptors will perceive the pain. This occurs when there is a stimuli, okay, initial nausea. Now, beyond this nociceptive pain, you are going to get the next pain that becomes an inflammatory pain. Okay, now what's an inflammatory pain is noxious stimuli continues to have its effect. Also, you're going to have an immune response attached to it. Okay, then inflammatory pain. Beyond inflammatory pain, you are going to have a problem. This is called pathological pain or maladaptive pain. This is what happens when you are going to deal with chronic osteoarthritis. That is why I wanted to put these slides. Pathological pain or maladaptive pain. This is where molecular, cellular, microanatomical, histological changes, everything takes place. Now, what happens here? The central nervous system has what is called as plasticity. Okay, it adapts. Okay, it adapts to pain changes. And then you have what is called as central sensitization for the pain. Okay, it has got central sensitization for the pain. Now, you have two kinds here. One is hyperalgesia. So a small pain stimulus will give a huge response. Or an allodynia. No pain itself will give you a response. You touch the animal, he will start screaming. You touch him on some other space, he'll start screaming. Okay. So this is what happens. So remember, don't let this pain go to this one. Go to a pathological pain. Okay. Similarly, when you get your synovial fluid, you easily evaluate. I told you, look for proteins. Non-inflammatory will have less than 2.5 gram per deciliter. Inflammatory and immune mediated will have more than 2.5 grams. And you know, septic, the inflammatory cells will be really high. Okay. Now, if someone wants to do something further, you have biomarkers. Okay. CRP is a biomarker which can easily be done in practice. The other biomarkers as well, which have a positive correlation with osteoarthritis. Matrix metalloproteinase. Tissue inhibitor of matrix metalloproteinase. TNF-alpha. These are highly sensitive biomarkers. And obviously, you know, the client should be willing to go ahead with it. Okay. Now let's come to radiography. Everyone knows we take two views. What are the common features of a joint disease? Osteophytes, enthesophytes, joint space widens, subchondral sclerosis, mineralization of the soft tissue structures, and remodeling. Okay, just very easy. So you are going to get, here you'll get osteophytes, here you'll get enthesophytes, joint space first widens, then narrows, subchondral bone, cysts and thickening and remodeling. Okay. Now, the very interesting thing. The most common radiographic change in mild to moderate osteoarthritis is osteophyte formation. Okay. Now, one of the studies was very interesting. What they have done is, now everyone has got digital radiography and computerized radiography. They have measured the width of the osteophyte in two places. One is at the cartilage junction. The other is the osteophyte you get between the femur head and the neck. Okay, I'll show you a picture later. So you measure the width of the osteophytes. That is supposed to be a really good indicator to assess the progression of osteoarthritis. Okay. And they actually go wide at 0.0036 millimeter per day. Okay. And then you see this, the irony of things here. The progression of radiographic osteoarthritis, that is why I told you it's a disease of young dogs. So radiographic osteoarthritis was significantly higher in young dogs and spayed female dogs compared to neutered males. Okay. So it's more in young dogs where the growth plate is not closed and in spayed female dogs. This is something you should keep in mind. Okay. Show you some pictures here. So radiography, how it helps. You see the OCD, osteochondrosis of the femoral head. The little trick here is to slightly rotate your limb when you, so don't take it in a neutral lateral view. You slightly externally rotate the limb. You'll be able to see the subchondral defect here. Similarly, osteoarthritis of the joint, of the elbow, very common. Elbow degenerative joint disease is pretty common. How it starts to see, this is a normal elbow. On your screen, on your left is a normal elbow. So in your normal elbow, you see the trochlear notch is very well shaped. You have a good trabecular pattern. Okay, what happens is, the first changes, what you get in an elbow, is your anconial process will start getting slightly thickened. This is your anconial process. Then you use your trabecular pattern, and then your first change, you see this? Your first change will be what is called as subtrochlear sclerosis. That is, under the semilunar, it will start getting much more thickened. You see that? So the first change will be subtrochlear sclerosis. Your hip. Hip is the most important thing. Hips don't lie. If people listen to this song, 1 minute. Shavan, I'm in lecture. I'll call you. I'm in lecture. So hip dysplasia, yeah, study has shown, greater than 75% of them have a risk of developing osteoarthritis, and more commonly in dogs which are more than 30 kilos. So there are many methods. If you want to see hip dysplasia, pin hip is a very popular method. You want to study degenerative joint disease, your traditional OFA, Orthopedic Foundation of America's VD view is good. Okay. Now, everybody knows this, but I want to show it to you. Oh, this doesn't play. So you want to do your hip dysplasia, you palpate the greater trochanter, adduct the limb, adduct it, you're pushing it down, then you push it into the head, and then you lift it up. Okay, that everyone knows, this is an Ottolone sign. Okay, that's called an Ottolone sign. That is a very simple test for diagnosing hip dysplasia. Good for you to do when the dog is in sedation. you'll get the head of the femur getting into the stabilum. You get a clink, a clunk, you feel it. Okay, it's a very easy method to do this. Right. There you go. Many of you have had this. An older method is to see the normal gangle. Draw 2 points in the center of the femoral head. Draw it through the cranial acetabulum, measure the angle. Anything above 105 is normal. Okay. Now you have some very interesting ways to find out, because you want to see osteoarthritis in the femur. One of the changes you will see is in the dorsal or the cranial acetabular rim. This is called a dorsal acetabular rim view. So you just pull the legs in front, you focus your beam here, you should be able to see changes in the cranial acetabulum, or you take a routine pelvis VD. What I want to stress here is, please give a lot of attention to your positioning when you take x-rays, because a little tilt will change your diagnosis. The most important when you take a ventrodorsal view is sedate the animal, number one. See that you cover your ili, the whole pelvis, up till the stifle. Okay. Three factors you need to make in mind. Two, one, your ileum should be same size. Two, your obturator foramen should be same in size. Three, your patella should be central in position. Only then you read your x-rays well. Otherwise, it's not a good idea. This is a picture showing a progression of the osteoarthritic changes. Okay, you look at the excellent positioning of the x-rays. Okay. What do you look for in an osteoarthritis of a hip? You look for something called the Morgan's line. Okay. So this is actually, it is called craniocaudal, that is on both sides of the hip, of the curvilinear osteophytes. So you have here the whole joint capsule. Let me use this print. See, this is where your joint capsule will end. Okay, so here is where you are going to get the craniocaudal curvilinear osteophytes, that is called the Morgan's line. Okay, this is pen hip method. We are not going to discuss this. This is for finding out laxity and hip dysplasia. Stifle. You look at the early. So typical of a stifle, it is what is called as a fat pad sign. Okay, what's a fat pad sign? This whole area gets normally should be transparent. Now, because of the lot of synovial fluid inflammation, the opacity increases, and then you know there is a, this is a cranial fat pad sign. Sometimes they also push the caudal fat pad thing, and also in many cases, the popliteal sesamoid is pushed to one side. Okay. Your advanced imaging, CT you do for bones, MRI is for soft tissues, scintigraphy you do for finding out what is the rate of metabolism. Okay. This is what I know you people were more interested in. The treatment. Now, you know the various conditions and how they look like in diagnosis and what a joint problem gives you. Okay. Basically, I have put, it's called four elements, but I put only three elements here. The number one is weight management. Number two is exercise. Third is medical treatment. We'll go through it. Basically, for managing DJD, you need to have a multimodal approach. One approach is not going to help you. Okay. So you have symptom modifying drugs. You have structure modifying drugs. Okay. We will see what are symptom modifying drugs and structure modifying drugs. Remember this. See this. There are two. There's a study. What a sentinel study, where many of what is a sentinel study means people voluntarily give information without asking. If you maintain a lean body mass, the lifespan is higher. Okay. And many of these cases, dogs which became free fed and obese, they had to put it down due to acute osteoarthritis. Okay. Second, clinical improvement in patients underwent weight control. Even with 6% reduction in body weight, that will help you. Just a small reduction in body weight is going to help you. So weight management is very important. A simple timeline. So you have some really good drugs. You have some really good feed in the market. Low energy, high weight, high proteins. Okay. So initially, what I generally do as a weight management program for dogs is I would automatically tell them, see, you can't suddenly start your dog on a commercial diet. People give a lot of rice and meat and dal and vegetables. The first thing I tell them is reduce your feed by 15%. Okay. 15%. So the 100 grams, I'll make it 85 grams. Okay, slowly I will shift him to a feed which gives it the obesity diet. So that at the 3 months, I will look for a 15% weight reduction. 6 months, about another 6% more, 21%. And at 10 months, you look for a 30% loss. So you would like to, an obese dog will have a body score of 9.9. I would like to reduce it to 7.9. Okay. This is in addition to your drugs which reduce pain. Okay. And exercise. Two drugs are being developed in the market. It's not come out as yet. They're more or less, this is for weight management in dogs. One is called mitratapide. The other is called dirlotapide. No drug regimen, dosage, etc. is available, but should be in the market soon in the US. It's not come in. So I expect these weight management drugs to come in too. So what they do is these work on this triglyceride transport mechanism. This is what how they work on. I do not know the modality how it works, but they are under advanced stages of development. Our mainstay, we'll talk about our mainstay. COX-1, COX-2 inhibitors. Everyone knows this. COX-1 is supposed to be the good guy. COX-2 is supposed to be the bad fellow. Okay. But remember, COX-2 also has an effect on the kidney and the GI tract. He's really, you can't call him the bad fellow. Now, they have identified another COX-3, okay, enzyme. Okay. So how does NSAIDs work? Don't go into the thing. They act against prostaglandins. See, what they do is they reduce the synthesis of what a thing called arachidonic acid. Arachidonic acid is responsible for prostaglandin formation. Prostaglandin, one of the most potent inflammatory things, is PGE4. It reduces it. Okay. Now you see the ratio between COX-1 to COX-2 is important when you treat. The lower the number, the better the beneficial effects. Studies have shown meloxicam has got a value of 3, carprofen has a value of 17, and aspirin has got a value of 166. Okay, so make your choice. This is something you have to really remember. Use NSAIDs with caution in dogs with renal disease. Because COX-2, okay, the good fellow, okay, has a basal expression in the kidneys, in dogs, then humans. It has a higher basal expression. Okay. Chronic kidney disease, COX-2 expression increases, the good fellow increases, and the shift of prostaglandin. So synthesis of prostaglandin is going to shift to this pathway, not from the COX-1 pathway. So if you're going to go NSAIDs, they are going to target this. And it is going to affect your renal function in dogs with kidney disease. Number one. Okay. Number two is the hepatic. So, what NSAIDs approved by FDA. Because I know we don't have much of studies in India. We base it on what US FDA approves. There are only 6 drugs approved as NSAIDs. Carprofen, meloxicam, firacoxib, derocoxib, etodolac and tepoxilin. Okay. These are the only 6 drugs. So carprofen, meloxicam, firacoxib, derocoxib, tepoxilin and etodolac. These are the only 6 drugs which have been approved by the FDA for use in dogs. Okay. You have aspirin. It's a non-FDA approved drug. That's a non-FDA approved drug. Okay. You have 2 other drugs which are coming into the market. One is called mavococcib. Supposed to be very advantageous because it has got the bioavailability is much more longer. The half-life is longer. And you have another drug which is coming in as rubinococcib. Like in India, you have carprofen, meloxicam, ferrococcib. Okay. These are 3 things which are available. Everyone knows it. Now, this is supposed to be one of the newer concepts which is coming. Galliprant. Galliprant is a novel drug for treating us. It's not come to India as such, or I don't know if it has come. I've had no official information on this. This contains a thing called gabiprant, which is a piperant group of drugs. Okay. This fellow is a non-cyclooxygenase inhibiting NSAID. Okay. Studies have shown very similar to other NSAIDs, very similar to NSAIDs. But what do you call as ADE, adverse drug effects, definitely is much less. So we all use carprofen very frequently. Very rarely, the carprofen, that is why we want to check the liver before we do it. Carprofen can cause idiopathic hepatic necrosis. Okay. That's why we always tell carprofen not to go beyond 3 weeks. Give it a break. Check the hepatic function. It can cause idiopathic hepatic necrosis. And that is not a good disease to have. So again, this guy, Grabiprant, it acts on prostaglandin EP4. Okay. And exerts its effect. This is getting, it's a pretty popular drug in the US. Okay. This is NSAIDs. What other drugs do we have in the market? You have got amantadine, gabapentin, acetaminophen. Acetaminophen is nothing but your paracetamol and your codeine. Okay. Amantadine is basically an antidepressant. It acts by this NMDA. It's an NMDA antagonist. Okay. This has a good effect when you combine it with NSAIDs. When NSAIDs alone is not effective, you combine amantadine or you combine gabapentin. The gabapentin, the loading dose is 10 mg per kg body weight twice daily. Now, one company, Decra. Decra has come out of the product which contains acetaminophen and codeine. Acetaminophen is paracetamol with codeine. Is a really good drug. They have reported very good results in dogs with osteoarthritis pain. In dogs which are not responsive to NSAIDs. Okay. Tramadol. I would not advise the practitioners to use Tramadol at all. Tramadol produces 8 metabolites in dogs. And only one metabolite has some pain-killing activity. And it only lasts for 2 hours. So I don't want to use it much. You could use it just mainly maybe to cause some sedation. Gabapentin, you know the dose in dogs. You can go up to 3 times. Cats, 5 milligrams. This is what I said. Amantadine, paracetamol. One more drug, which I'm sure all of us would love to have. Okay, it's available in humans. Cannabidiol oil. Okay. Initially, that oil is something you put on yourself. Nope. So it is, I think, available online. It's available as hemp oil, if I'm right. Some of you may be able to give more information. I have never used it. It's an excellent analgesic property. Because all over your body, you have got these cannabinoid receptors, CB1 and CB2. Okay. It's also present in the synovium. Excellent drug to have. Cannabinoid oil should be given at a dose rate of 2 milligram per kilogram body weight orally. It's not an oil to be applied on the surface of the body. Okay, we go quickly. The second thing is your improving joint fluids. Okay. The best way to improve joint fluid is hyaluronic acid, because hyaluronic acid is the building block of protoamyloglycans. Okay, you can inject probably hyaluronic acid. 0.3 to 0.5 ml. Okay. So we have seen symptom modifying drugs. Now we are going to go to structure modifying drug, what is available in our country. One good drug which is available in our country is this Pentars 100. And it contains pentosan sulfate. Okay. 3 milligram per kg once daily for 4 weeks. It's supposed to have a lot of beneficial effects because A, it hits your pro-inflammatory cytokines. B, what it does, it has got a heparin-like activity. So whatever clots, little clots, it sort of cleaves the clots, improves the blood circulation to your joint. Okay, I have used this drug. It is pretty effective and I will encourage people to use this. It's a pretty good drug. Okay. Obviously, use SAD-MOAs, slow-acting disease-modifying osteoarthritic agents. You got to wait. Patience is the key here. Adequan, not available in India, but I have used it. We have some people who went abroad have got it. So it is a really good drug. Every one of you know this. Chondroprotectives. Every one of us use this in large quantities. Glucosamine, chondroitin sulfate. Synergistic. Okay. You should know what is the glucosamine you need to use. Okay. So what do these guys do? It inhibits the damage to the cartilage, has an anabolic effect, helps in building, reduces, counters your enzymes, antioxidants, etc. So the glucosamine what you use should be glucosamine sulfate. Check when you prescribe. Does this product contain sulfate? Because sulfur is very, very beneficial for your joints. Okay. You have got two other varieties of glucosamine, but I would avoid that. Use glucosamine sulfate. Okay, that is one thing you should see in your label. Then use your chondroitin sulfate. Chondroitin also improves vascularity to the joints. So, if you have a dog with osteoarthritis, I would like to give it definitely fatty acids, omega-3, omega-6 fatty acids, high level of linoleic, chondroprotectives, carnitine, and antioxidants. Miscellaneous drugs. I don't know if you heard of it. Doxycycline. All acute osteoarthritis cases with dogs, I prescribe doxycycline. Why? Doxycycline, what happens is, it reduces the level of nitrous oxide, NO. No. Says no to osteoarthritis, nitrous oxide. It reduces what is called, it has what is called as an anti-streamolysin activity. Okay. 10 mg per kg body weight, single dose daily. Add it to your regimen with dogs with pain. You'll find a lot of change. They are also superoxide radical scavengers. Like superoxide dismutase is produced, cathepsin G sodium is produced. They're very good with that. Your omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids. What is omega-3? It has eicosopentaenoic acid and docohexaenoic acid. Okay. Your dose should be 270 to 360 milligram per kg. Okay. I forgot to add this to you. Glucosamine, general dose which is prescribed, is about 40 milligram to 44 milligram per kg. Chondroitin, 15 to 30 milligram per kg. This is what is your dose as a nutraceutical. And EPA is 270 to 360 mg. Omega-6. Omega-6, you will get what? There are two things. One is called linoleic acid. You will get it in soya bean oil. Okay. Avoid arachidonic acid, but you get it in animal fat. As I told you, not much of fat should be given. Steroids. Low dose have an anti-arthritic effect and it reduces the formation of osteophytes. See? We used to use a drug called, everybody knows, called Depo-Medrol. Methyl prednisolone succinate. Okay. Now, a recent study where what they have done is, they have combined triamcinolone, you get Vetalog, isn't it? And hyaluronidase. They've given each of them separately. They've also combined it. It is 20, sorry, it's not 20 mg per kg. Sorry about this. Okay, I'm not going to do anything. I don't want to give you something wrong. So it is 20 mg into each joint. Okay. Some studies they have done, they have got excellent pain relief. So if you have a joint which is going from bad to worse, despite your initial multimodal therapy, I'll suggest you to do this. Okay. we'll see a couple of new concepts and then we'll finish up. Now, something which is really getting, you know, probably should come into the market very soon is something called, see, you have got something called nerve growth factor. So what they're trying to develop is something called a monoclonal antibody against the nerve growth factor. Because nerve growth factor concentrations are very high in synovial fluid and osteoarthritis, it causes a lot of pain. So studies, it's not come into the market. They have got a single injection they have tried. This is by a company called NexVet. The drug's name is RainVetMab. RainVetMab at 0.2 mg per kg IV, single dose, has an effect as much as, you know, a course of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. This drug has not come into the market yet. Okay. This is very popular method of therapy. End stage osteoarthritis, we want to try so many things. We want to try corticosteroids, and then we want to try stem cells. Stem cells are to become very popular now. Okay. I do not know the efficacy because I have not tried, I have not done it much. You can have adipose-derived mesenchymal stem cells. Mesenchymal stem cells with platelet-rich plasma. This is something which is getting, which has got given very good results. I mean, the platelet-rich plasma. Or you can combine mesenchymal cells with hyaluronic acid. So platelet, what is platelet-rich plasma? Platelet-rich plasma is when you concentrate a volume of blood, okay? Normal quantity of platelets, you would be, you know, maybe 1.5 lakhs to 3 lakhs. When you concentrate it, it becomes, you make it up to 10 lakhs. And when you concentrate your platelets, the amount of growth factors which it present in the concentration is much more higher. And the effect is far more potent. So how do you do it? It's a very, very simple process. Okay. You centrifuge the blood. Okay, you centrifuge it first. After centrifuging, then you discard the top layer, which is called the buffy coat. The bottom layer is the packed cell volume. You take the central layer first. Again, the central layer in the first centrifuge is not going to have enough platelets. You re-centrifuge it again. Okay, so that you get, and then you need to get these polypropylene tubes. You can't do it in ordinary glass tubes. Okay. And you take, get two fractions, and you could use the platelet-rich plasma. What you need to do is you need to get the platelets to degranulate. So for that, you can add your calcium. It's a pretty simple process. Any one of you can learn it in your practice. You can get your centrifuge, you know, you can buy it on Amazon. It's not a big deal. It has a large efficacy in treating musculoskeletal injuries. Now, this is something which seems to be revolutionizing osteoarthritis, at least in major practices in the West. Okay. This is now nuclear medicine which has come to treat osteoarthritis. Okay. This is radiation therapy, basically. Okay. It's a targeted therapy. It's a radioisotope. It's called TIN-117M, 117M. Very simple OP procedure under sterile conditions. It's given very good success for elbow osteoarthritis pain. What this guy does is it targets the pro-inflammatory macrophages. Okay. It spares your synovites, synoviocytes, not synovites, synoviocytes. Supposed to give, it's one shot is effective for 1 year. 1 year pain-free life. This is what has been reported in there. Again, so for me, I do not know, seriously, this is all in research concept, the stem cells, okay? We're still not too sure, including botulinum toxin. The final thing is your physical therapy. Very, 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 very important. Okay, please excuse the spelling here. The American Pain Management Association, if I'm right, they have approved four methods for pain management, for osteoarthritis. Acupuncture, myofascial trigger point therapy, therapeutic laser, and pulsed acoustic wave therapy. Okay, these are four things which they have approved for use. Acupuncture being the most popular one in the order of this. You also have other stuff. Exercise, hydrotherapy is a very good method. Pulsed electromagnetic field therapy, TENS, transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation, etc. Okay. Simple. You have an acute, let's say you have an acute flare-up of osteoarthritis, animal is painful, cold. Simple. Causes vasoconstriction. Okay. Chronic, what? Everyone knows that. Regular stretching exercise. One of the regular stretching exercises is the using the physio ball, getting the animal climb on it, the physio ball. Then you have this isometric, isotonic, isokinetic, and isoronic kind of exercises. Isometric is nothing but simple walking. Isokinetic is a walk with resistance. Okay. And I would think isotonic is something like hydrotherapy. Basic physiotherapist would be able to explain better on this. Okay. Do I have some little more time? 10 minutes? Doctor? Okay. Let me go through since I have not. So these are the surgery. Now I showed you all the medical management. Give me 10 more minutes. I'll go through this quickly because many of you know this. Surgical treatment of DJD is the most important procedure for a... So in surgical treatment also, you have palliative and support and curative. Curative is only replacements, elbow replacement, hip replacements. We are not there yet. But there are methods where you can try and do joint debridement, curettage, muscle release, osteotomy, arthroplasties, pseudarth, false joints, arthro disease, amputations is the end stage scenario. You take OCD, you do arthrotomy or arthroscopy. I would prefer to do an arthrotomy. Okay. OCD is basically a defect and encounter ossification where the cartilage does not become bone and it sorts of irritates your joint, it breaks off, falls into your joint, it's called joint mites, becomes osteochondritis dissecans, causes a lot of inflammation. Best is to remove it. Okay. Arthroscopy is a better method, needs more skills and equipment. Now, this is supposed to be minimally invasive. Elbow, severe elbow degenerative joint disease, they are doing elbow replacements. It's called TER, total elbow replacement. This implant is called Tate implant. Okay. This is a surfacing arthroplasty. Open up, resurface the joints and put the implants in. Okay. It has been done in the West. We have not come to hip replacements yet. This is our mainstay. You do not have DJD, good for us. You can do juvenile pubic symphysiotis, triple pelvic osteotomy, or other two have been outdated. Very, very simple surgery to do in practice. Okay? So, you close 1/3 to 2/3 of the pelvic symphysis. You do it within 20 weeks. There will be an antiversion. The one part of your acetabulum will rotate up to 6.8 to 7 degrees. Okay. So very simple surgery. Open the symphysis. And then that's your pubic symphysis. Okay. So pretty straightforward procedure to do. So you use a simple electrocautery, 25 watts for 30 seconds. You cauter about 2/3. You cause the pubis to close. There will be a ventroversion. Okay. This is a nice paper and record. Okay. Now you see this. 6 months later. Okay. I have a living proof of a very successful juvenile pubic symphysiotis. I would think probably that was the first one done. It was for my dog. I did it in 2011, very typically dysplastic hip. Now I have a really good picture of the hip sitting in very well. Because you do triple pelvic osteotomies is one method. You cut the pelvis in three places and put a special plate. Okay? Or DPO. I know some of the people in India are doing double pelvic osteotomy as well. There's a company called Fixin which is giving it. You need two cuts. Okay, post-op care is something which is very important. You want to get rid of pain, our mainstay, our bread and butter has been excision arthroplasty. That is femoral head and neck osteotomy. Very good for dogs less than 25 kilos. But remember, this procedure should be done well. If you leave a little bit of a spur behind, then you're done. The animal will still continue to be in pain. Okay? See that you get a neat cut and you get your femur, head and neck out of the way. Okay? Some pictures on osteoarthritis after doing an FHO. Total hip replacement. Expensive procedure. In referral hospitals and university hospitals, it's a $5,000 surgery. Chronic lameness, severe degenerative joint disease. It's the best method available. Simple. The best method to take osteoarthritis of the hip is total hip. So you have two methods. One is called cemented. The other is called a biological fixation. A total hip, which has been done on a dog. Okay. Another method to get rid of pain in osteoarthritis is it's a simpler technique called surgical denervation. No big deal to do the surgery. Do a good dissection. Minimally invasive. What you do is, in all these areas, okay, I'm sorry, this picture is sort of rotated. You will debride the sensory nerve endings which come here. But you're supposed to get rid of your pain. That is all. The arthritis will never go away. It's an easy technique to do, good technique to do in practice. These are the areas which you will just take either a free air or a periosteal elevator and scrape that area off. That is all. So the sensory nerve endings to the joint are cut off. Everyone knows this. See, crocheted ligament, the typical beautiful draw which you see in this, causes an unstable joint. This is due to trauma. Okay, now see this, just to show you this. See, it goes and opens and closes like a draw. Once, so there are about 10 techniques which are available to stabilize this. Okay, still, the most popular technique is something called TPLO. Tibia plate leveling osteotomy. Okay, so what we do? See, this is a very simple method where we crimp it. Very simple method. It's called a lateral imbrication technique. The final patella luxations can cause arthritis. Okay, so you do something called a rectangular chondroplasty. Okay, use this Insall-Salvati equation to do it. OCD is the stifled joint. Okay. Newer concepts which have not been established yet, joint debridement, micro picking, and removal of loose fragment, they have not still been implemented. Finally, you also get osteoarthritis of the spine. Two things, spondylosis or discospondylitis. Spondylosis is a degeneration of the intervertebral disc. Infection of the intervertebral disc and its surrounding end plates are called discospondylitis. Arthroscopy. Excellent technique, less invasive, more rapid, weight bearing is more quick, costly investment. So with this, you can get rid of lots of problems. Okay. Final two slides. You also get inflammatory osteoarthritis, or you call it as arthropathies, treated with appropriate antibiotics. Non-inflammatory, one of the things you get is polyarthritis, multiple joints, or rheumatoid arthritis. Mostly steroids are the main choice. Okay. To finish, okay, you do not have a possible cure to osteoarthritis. That's the simple thing. The main thing for a vet is to reduce the progression of the disease, improve quality of life, reduce joint pain, increase joint mobility, reduce cartilage destruction. This is the max you can do. You know it earlier, you use the coat staging. You do it earlier, the better. Okay? So that's as much as what I wanted to tell you. Is that? Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir.
So.
Yeah, please. You like to say anything? Over.
Shall I stop the share?
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you very much, sir. That was really a very deep depth and elaborative session.
Thank you very much.
I really enjoyed it, and I have seen a lot of comments live during the session that they really like the topic. They really like the content, the treatment and diagnosis part you have just spoken about.